I'll write up. Hi there, I'm Gail Eichenthal, host and executive producer of KUSC Los Angeles and KDB Santa Barbara, and I'm thrilled to be the host of the Ojai Festival web stream this year. Coming up on our second concert of this evening, a masterclass in percussion. Now forget about whiplash, okay? This concert is gonna make whiplash look like the Little Mermaid. Now, I hope we won't have any blood spilled tonight, but there is actually a piece that requires the performer to play his body. It's called Corporel by the French-born Vinko Globicar. We have one solo artist tonight, the amazing Stephen Schick, who is the music director of the 2015 Ojai Festival, the first time a percussionist has ever held that honor. And he has himself commissioned or premiered more than 150 works. He likes to say that he's older than most of the works that he plays in his vast and adventurous repertoire. And we're going to begin tonight with music of a composer with whom Stephen Schick had a close relationship, Yannis Xenakis, the fascinating architect, philosopher, and composer. And that X for Xenakis, Stephen Schick feels is very significant. He says it makes him feel better about the fact that some of Xenakis' music is literally impossible to play. And he says that, you know, an artist who's spent their lifetime studying and teaching at the university level likes to think of themselves as accomplished, but some of the music of Xenakis to this day reduces him to feeling very, very small indeed. So that's, he's gonna get one of those challenges out of the way with a very opening piece, and then Xenakis closes the program as well. In between, we have a number of very diverse works, including music of David Lang, the wonderful American composer, Pulitzer Prize winner for The Little Match Girl, who has had such an impact on choral music, on theatrical music. This is a piece called The Anvil Chorus, and it was inspired by medieval blacksmiths who had a habit of singing in rhythm and beating in a certain way. Why? To avoid bonking each other on the hand with their hammers. So we're going to see in that piece, Stephen Schick with a battery of junk metal, making like not just one medieval blacksmith, but a whole group of medieval blacksmiths working together. Fascinating music. We'll also hear Lei Liang's work entitled Trans, and he says that could be transformation, that could be transience. The audience is invited to take part in that piece. They've been invited to pick up stones in the park here at Libby Bowl, and they will be conducted on stage by Stephen Schick. So in that piece, the audiences will make the sounds, and he will tell them about how to use their rocks to get the most effect. So we're going to have literally a masterclass in rock music, if you will. The probably the landmark piece on this program, and you can hear that we're getting close to the concert, the landmark piece would have to be Karlheinz Stockhausen's Cyclus, or Cycle, from 1959, very early on in this really remarkable composer's career, a spiritual man. Toward the end of his life, Stockhausen was writing a piece for each hour of the day, and he got up to the 21st hour out of 24 when he died in his late 70s in 2007. Cycle employs graphic notation. You don't know where you're supposed to start. You're supposed to decide at the moment of performance where to begin. The score resembles more of a notebook, and the composer himself admitted that the sheet music looks a little more like a painting by Paul Klee than, say, a Schubert song or a Beethoven symphony. So remarkably challenging music, showing all of the possibilities of what percussion can be. And as I mentioned, one of our works, Vinco Globicar's Corporel, will actually require Stephen Schick to not only play parts of his body percussively, but also to make some sort of nonverbal sounds. So it's going to be an absolute thrilling phantasmagoria of percussion music on tonight's program here at the Ojai Festival. An exhaustive, thrilling weekend, 20 concerts, 47 different composers. Three-fourths of them are alive and well today, and that's really a remarkable achievement for the adventurous programming of the artistic director of the 2015 Ojai Festival, Tom Morris, who, oh, incidentally, is also a percussionist. You will enjoy this program, I'm sure. It will be quite a mind-blower. I'm Gail Eichenthal. So great to be with you.
Thank you.
Executive producer at KUSC Los Angeles and KDV Santa Barbara, and the host of our Ojai Festival 2015 web stream. Delighted to be here. And with me, just about to start an amazing concert of her own, is one of the superstars of contemporary music in the world today. Cellist Maya Beiser, who has premiered hundreds of works, many of them written, tailored for her remarkable talents. She juggles the world of classical, contemporary, rock, jazz, everything in between. And it is such a pleasure to talk to you and to introduce you to our audience.
Thank you, Gail. I'm very happy to be here.
So I heard in your TED Talk, which has been seen about a million times, and which features some astounding performances, highly, highly recommend, you said that when a composer sets out to fulfill a commission, you tell them to sort of forget everything they normally think about with the cello, that the cello should not necessarily be restricted to the world of Bach, Beethoven, Schubert, and so forth. Talk about where your own sort of open-mindedness and open-heartedness with this concept came from. Were you born a musical adventuress?
I think I was born a world adventurer. I was born in a small little kibbutz in the Galilee in Israel, and I was immersed in classical music since I was a little girl, but I was surrounded by all this other kind of music, Arabic music, Argentinian music of my father, my mother's French. So it was a melting pot of a lot of different cultures, and I've always was fascinated by all these different kinds of music, and I wanted to open up the cello to a world of possibilities. And just for me, it became about the cello as this vehicle to express, to communicate the kind of artistry that I was interested in. And I didn't want to be boxed in to a particular dogma or genre. So I seek out people who I think would kind of take a leap and who would open up a new avenue and who would change the world in one way or another. And so it's very important for me never to just kind of limit it within a particular parameters.
So, of course, as a cellist, you play Bach, and you probably practice Bach mm-hmm. and Beethoven and so forth. But then there is the whole world of electronics and rock. I gather that hearing the voice of Janis Joplin had an effect on you as a young musician. Tell us about that.
Yeah. Well, so I was a classical music geek, and the first time I heard Janis Joplin, I was 16. And I was shaken to the core. It just kind of turned my world upside down. And I thought, she became my idol. And I thought, I wanted to play the cello the way that she sings. This wow. kind of raw expression, this fearlessness, just was so powerful to me. And so tomorrow, actually, I am performing Summertime, which is Janis' interpretation of Gershwin. And inspired by her, my latest album was all about rock and roll and how I was sort of reimagine it for the cello.
Yeah, the Uncovers, Led right. Zeppelin, right. Kurt Cobain, just an astounding variety of rock musicians mm-hmm. that you kind of make your own interpretation of. And that's a free concert tomorrow afternoon. If you happen to be watching us in the vicinity of Ojai, California, you've got to be there. It's going to be amazing. Tonight, you're performing a concert that includes music of Michael Harrison. And I must tell you that after a very long day yesterday, a bunch of concerts and receptions and talks, some of us were walking back from the Ojai Arts Center, and we were exhausted. And we were almost experiencing the siren call of your cello rehearsing here in the Libby Bowl at 11 at night. And we could not go to our cars. We had to come to the, we had to come and hear what you were doing. And I believe you were practicing the Michael Harrison. Tell us about that piece. What an incredible sound.
It is really one of the greatest pieces I've ever played. I think that this piece is just a miracle. It's magic. It's inspired by the idea of just intonation, music of the spheres, the idea of how music exists in nature. There is a film by Bill Morrison, which was created for the music in a reverse idea. And the piece just uses the cello in this remarkable way and really takes it on this great journey.
It's haunting music, as I say. It lured us into the park. You begin with a beautiful musical elegy by Osvaldo Golioff, and I had the great privilege of hearing you play it at the Green Music Center when I was up in Northern California working with KDFC.
Yeah.
You played it with the Santa Rosa Symphony.
That's right.
What a beautiful, moving work.
Yeah, I thought it was very important for us to play it here because this was the first piece that Steve Schick and I commissioned together. Steve Schick and I go a long way. We've, we met at Bang on a Can, which is the new music festival in New York. We were founding member of the Bang on a Can All-Stars, and then we started to commission works for cello and percussion. This was the first piece that we commissioned. Osvaldo wrote this heart-wrenching, beautiful lament. So we're opening with it tonight.
Have you performed his Azul?
Yes.
You have.
In fact, we just performed it 2 months ago with Steve conducting, with the La Jolla Symphony.
That is one of the greatest works I've heard in the last 10 years.
Fantastic. And Osvaldo is
blue in Spanish.
Right. Yeah. And he's a dear friend. We have very similar background. He also hails from Argentina, went to Israel. His music is just fantastic.
Who is the memorial for? I gather a friend of the composer.
Marielle was a friend of Osvaldo. She died in a car accident on her way to Brazil to a vacation. So this is a memorial for her.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
We talked last night with Glenn Cochi, who wrote a piece that is going to be played tomorrow afternoon. And
Right. Tell
us about that collaboration.
Oh, God.
He's amazing. We're talking about Wilco's drummer extraordinaire and a composer and performer in his own right.
Glenn is just, force of nature. He's such a great guy. And he's been touring with me now for the past year on this with the Uncovered concert. And I didn't want it to go without presenting some of his music because he's a fantastic composer, so I commissioned him to write this piece for me. It's a fabulous piece. I like to think about it as Bach on steroids, because it's literally, all this Bach-like arpeggios, except that you have eight live delays that are processing the cello, making this kind of massive sound, and it's a fantastic piece.
Well, you have a lot of work ahead of you this evening.
Yeah.
So I want to thank you so much for stopping by and chatting at the Ojai Festival Webstream. Maya Beiser, what a pleasure it is
to meet you
and talk to you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
We say break a bow.
Yeah. I don't want to do that.
No, you don't.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for being here tonight. Thank you. Thank you, Tom Morris, for inviting me. I am just thrilled to be here. And thank you to everybody at the festival, the staff, everyone here who has made us all, I mean, Ice, Renga, Redfish, Bluefish, Wuman, Maya, everybody involved here, so welcome. Thank you very much. And a special thanks to Redfish Bluefish, my students. You may have noticed that everything is running a little long, and without them, I'd still be setting up. And without them, I'd be immeasurably poorer in life. So thank you to you all. I really appreciate that. Now, under your seats is not the keys to a new car, I hate to tell you. But you do have, I think most of you, two beautiful, I hear you've got them. Tom, what were we thinking? Just a quick word about this piece. Lei Liang, my friend and colleague at UC San Diego, wrote this piece for my 60th birthday last year, in which 60 pairs of sea stones were passed out to the audience. And you'll see what happens. I'm going to give you a little tutorial. But then I thought, well, you know, I have aspirations to live much longer than the age 60. I was reading the Old Testament, and I thought 1,000 seemed right. And so let me show you what to do with this. I think you already know. I mean, like all percussion instruments, you can learn how to play them in about 3 seconds. You, by the way, the secret is that you hit them. If you take the larger of the two stones and put it in your cupped palm, no one said to play it yet. Take a sort of pointed end and hit it. That's excellent. Now, just listen to this. Really, you may not want to quit your day jobs just yet. But the lessons are going well. So listen to what happens. If I cup my hand, so it is putting as much air under the rock as possible, I get that sound. If I cup my hand, I get that sound. As I flatten it, you can make different notes. Yes, it is magic. Try that for approximately 12 seconds and no longer. Fantastic. Let's consider that a success. Now, here's what I'd like to do. I'm going to conduct you at 3 or 4, depending on how I feel, moments in this piece to do certain kinds of material. There will be a light conducting that looks like this, that should be basically the sound of a rainstorm, such as the one we had the other day. Not heavy, just sort of gradual drops like this. And if you could choose a number between 1 and 5 and count to that number between times that you play the rocks, we should have, with this many people, just about the right amount of noise. Can we try that? This is the signal for this. It's very complicated. This is what I'm... Try this. This is the early rainstorm. Even less, even thinner. Listen to what is happening around you. Some people should play higher sounds, maybe others lower. Now, if I do this, I'd like the sound to move in the space, so that means that over here there's more sound. And now over here. You should be able to hear the sound traverse the space. At one point in the piece, and I think you'll know, because honestly, it's very exciting. I'll come to a sort of big moment, and then the power trio, Fist in the Sky, I'll give you that. And then can we have your maximum rain shower effort? Let's try it. Now, that's very good, but I think you'll find it's more interesting if you don't try to play as fast as possible, but that you play sporadic bursts. You'll find more interesting rhythms. Can we try that one? Yeah. That's good. That's good. You're an integral part of this piece. I hope you enjoy Lei Liang's Trance.
Chica.
I recently read the following remark. The history of humankind is a long succession of synonyms for the same word. It is our duty to disprove this. Thank you.
Thank you.
I have prepared an encore. Actually, we have another 8 concerts to go. I would like to read for you a poem by Wendell Berry, the ecologist, environmentalist, great American poet. I'd like to read this in the memory of my father, who was the greatest farmer I knew. It's called the Mad Farmer Liberation Front. Love the quick profit, annual raise, vacation with pay. Want more of everything ready-made. Be afraid to know your neighbor and to die. And you will have a window in your head. Not even your future will be a mystery anymore. Your mind will be punched in a car and filed away in a little drawer. When they want you to buy something, they will call you. When they want you to die for profit, they'll let you know. So friends, every day, do something that won't compute. Love the Lord. Love the world. Work for nothing. Take all that you have and be poor. Love someone who does not deserve it. Denounce the government and embrace the flag. Hope to live in that free republic for which it stands. Give your approval to all you cannot understand. Praise ignorance, for what man has not encountered, he has not destroyed. Ask the questions that have no answers. Invest in the millennium. Plant sequoias. Say that your main crop is the forest, that you did not plant, that you will not live to harvest. Say that the leaves are harvested once they have rotted into the mold. Call that profit. Prophesy such returns. Put your faith in the 2 inches of humus that will grow under the trees every 1,000 years. Listen to carrion. Put your ear close and hear the faint chattering of the songs that are to come. Expect the end of the world. Laugh. Laughter is immeasurable. Be joyful, though you have considered all the facts. So long as women do not go cheap for power, please women more than men. Ask yourself, will this satisfy a woman satisfied to bear a child? Will this disturb the sleep of a woman near to giving birth? Go with your love to the fields. Lie easy in the shade. Rest your head in her lap. Swear your allegiance to what is nighest your thoughts. As soon as the generals and politicos can predict the motions of your mind, lose it. Leave it to mark the false trail, the way you didn't go. Be like the fox who leaves more tracks than necessary, some in the wrong direction. Practice resurrection. Thank you very much.
Hi again, I'm Gail Eichenthal, executive producer at KUSC and KDB Santa Barbara, and we've just heard an astounding, life-altering solo percussion recital by the music director of the 2015 Ojai Festival, Stephen Schick. No rest for the weary. He is going to be participating in the late night concert here at Libby Bowl, as well joining our wonderful cellist who visited us at intermission, Maya Beiser. So stick around. We've got some great contemporary music ahead. In the meantime, one of the stars of this weekend's festival is Claire Chase, flutist extraordinaire, and founder, artistic director of ICE, the International Contemporary Ensemble, which has really revolutionized the way that music is presented, commissioned, the way it's taught, and the way it's marketed. And I salute you for all you've done for contemporary music.
Thank you.
Let's start at the very beginning of your own sort of foray into the contemporary world. And I gather a piece that we heard you play last night, Density 21.5, a solo flute piece by Edgar Varèse, which was part of an absolutely amazing first half of the concert last night. Four works of Varèse on the same program. Very unusual. When did you first hear it? How did it affect you? And how has it influenced as you go forward with some of your projects?
Well,
this
Density,
little piece, this little piece.
Yeah, it's this 4.5 minute piece, you know, and those 4.5 minutes have completely changed my life. I encountered the piece when I was 13. My teacher at the time, wonderful, wonderful man named John Fonville in San Diego, California, he came into my lesson and brought this piece in, and I thought it was the strangest looking thing I'd ever seen. And he played it for me, and I swear to God, every dog in the neighborhood was howling, and he almost broke all of the windows in the house. But it was a before and after moment of my life. And I didn't know what to call it, but I said, this is what I want to do. Wow. This is an astounding experience. It's an astounding artistic experience. It's an astounding sonic experience. It was an astounding human experience. And I didn't know how to play it. You know, the piece requires this. It's a virtuosity, but not a virtuosity in terms of lots and lots of notes and lots of fancy licks and turns and trills. It requires this total focus, and it requires control over your sound at every register, at every dynamic. And for a 13-year-old kid who was just trying to figure out how to play a sound, I had a bunch of braces in my mouth and was struggling with the high register, the low register, and everything in between. It presented this challenge that was just, it seemed impossible, but the impossibility of it just became this fuel for what I wanted to do. And I became totally obsessed with the piece, and as I told Ara this morning, so obsessed that I tried to program the piece on my junior high school graduation.
Was, oh boy.
Summarily shut down and had to play Danny Boy instead. But my passion for contemporary music, for the cause of contemporary music, and for just wanting to share that experience with as many people as I possibly could, began there with the rejection of not being able to play it on a football field. And you know, it's marked my search for new music since then, and it's marked my dedication to this ensemble whose reason for being is to create a repertory of composers of our time.
Absolutely. And before we talk about ICE and how that came to be, tell us a little bit about Density 2036, a way that you are honoring the beginnings of your contemporary worldview with this amazing project.
Thank you. Well, the piece is, the 21.5 in the piece, I should say, refers to the density of platinum. And it was written for one of the first flutes made entirely of platinum. And so it's not just a piece that searches for a future language and for a way of expressing through humankind's oldest instrument. You know, the flute is the oldest instrument, the newest sounds. But it's also about finding a new metal and honoring the sound of that new metal. And so the project I came up with is called Density 2036. The piece was written in 1936. And in 2036, at the 100th anniversary of the piece, I will have commissioned 24 years of new repertory in honor of Density and its fearlessness and its fierceness and its seeking for the new.
So any idea how many pieces that will be by then?
No
have
idea.
Done the math?
you know, What's fun about the project is that some of the pieces will be miniatures. They'll be 30 seconds long, a minute long. Some of them might be 24 hours long. Mm-hmm. Some year I might do a piece by a single composer, and it might last several days. And
say,
other years I might do, you know, a concert that lasts 3 minutes. I don't know.
Yeah. I was going to say, Morton Feldman is no longer with us. He tended to write long. And you're playing a 4.5 hour piece on Sunday morning of Morton Feldman's, as if you didn't have enough to do on the evening concerts. But that is just such a thrilling project. So talk about how ICE came to be. You were fellow students at the Oberlin Conservatory.
We loved playing together and loved creating new pieces together. And my last year at Oberlin had an opportunity to put 15 members of the Contemporary Music Ensemble together to do a project in honor of the year 2000. And that really was the genesis of the group. And we sort of fast forward a year, I landed in Chicago and was really inspired by what was happening in the experimental theater scene mm-hmm. in Chicago, and thought, okay, if this is happening in theater, why can't this happen in contemporary music? And there were all these really interesting little independent theaters doing really groundbreaking work, operating on shoestring budgets, but just doing astonishing things. And so we decided to try our luck and give that a shot as a contemporary music outfit. Got nonprofit status. We had this crazy dream of having a national and eventually international organization that would have local outposts in the East Coast, Midwest, eventually the West Coast. And we came up with a kind of nutty idea, which was 5 years in Chicago, then 5 years in New York, and then around the 15th year, we would start establishing ourselves on the West Coast. And it's, you know, dreams are a funny thing. Sometimes they just manifest. And we've done exactly that. We started with a shoestring budget in the year 2000, started in Chicago, had 5 great years there. We moved to New York while keeping our Chicago season alive. And the group now has a budget of about $1.5 million. We do about 125 concerts around the world, and we've commissioned over 800 pieces. So we're having a good time.
Wow, 800 pieces. That is just something else. And you yourself have premiered, as we mentioned, about 100.
I've lost count.
You've lost count. Okay. And more to come, obviously. That's so incredible. You mentioned Ara. That's Ara Guzulemian, who runs the marvelous Ojai Talks. Old friend of mine and former KUSC director, and you were telling him today about a very important milestone in your career in the last couple of years, and that is winning one of the MacArthur Fellowships, the famous Genius Grants, which I believe is a couple of years ago. So tell us about how you found out. That's what everybody always wants to know. What were you doing? Were you sleeping? Were you showering?
I was in a sound check. You know, I spend a lot of my life in a sound check for a concert. I was in a sound check, and I couldn't take the call, obviously, because I was reporting for duty. But it was a very long 20 minutes where I received a message that was cryptic enough from the director of the MacArthur Fellows Program, saying, you need to return my call urgently.
Where were you doing the sound check?
This was in Brooklyn, in Williamsburg. I eventually called him back and had a very long conversation with him, which was drawn out. and when he finally gave me the news, right on cue, just as if John Cage and Edgar Varese could just have a love child right in that moment, which they kind of did. A siren on a fire truck came whizzing by, and I could barely make out the conversation. Really wasn't sure whether this was actually happening or whether I was imagining this, and I couldn't make out any of the information that he was telling me, all the important things I was supposed to do and not do, and all of that. And it was kind of a ridiculous scene from there. I tried to duck into a Cuban restaurant at one point to have some sound insulation. I got kicked off of an old lady's stoop for loitering while I was trying to have this phone call. And at the end of it, I still couldn't believe it. And I biked home and then came back and played the concert. And
Now, you were supposed to keep that news fairly confidential, I understand.
For 2 weeks.
Two weeks.
You're allowed to tell one person.
But that's impossible. You're playing with these people that you've played with for years.
Yeah.
You're all part of the same, you know, really revolution in contemporary music. How can you not tell the whole room?
It was challenging.
Yeah. Well, you have already embarked on some very, very ambitious projects as a result of the MacArthur Grant, and I know there's more to come. Tell us a little bit about ICE Lab, if you would.
ICE Lab is a laboratory for emerging composers. It's a program we started at ICE about 4 years ago. And the idea was to give composers in our generation the optimal environment to create new pieces of music. So often composers write in isolation, performers practice and hone their craft in isolation, and we get an opportunity to work together and talk together as human beings and as collaborators very late in the process. And so ICE Lab inverts that, puts everybody together very early in the process, and it also embraces what we like to think of as kind of an icy philosophy, a holistic philosophy of not ever seeing a separation between the composer and the performer, between the performer and the audience, between our educational work and our audience building work, and just between all aspects of the creative process and of the process of bringing a work to life and then sharing that. Yeah. You know, where a work is performed, how it's performed, whether it's a small venue or a large venue, all of those considerations are, they're creative acts and they're part of the process. And so in ICE Lab, those conversations start from the very beginning with all of the musicians and the composers. And we figure it out together. We duke it out together. So ICE Lab is sort of our attempt at creating a utopian creative environment to bring into being what we saw as the most important works by composers in our generation. And it's been a blast. I mean, we've created all these new pieces, performed them in over 300 concerts around the world, everywhere from, you know, stadiums to black box theaters to public spaces to boats on the Amazon River, you name it. I mean, anything can be performance space.
Glacier, I believe, too?
Yes, we did a piece on kayaks amongst glaciers in the far north in Greenland.
I wish I'd
been
there.
Just a couple months ago.
Well, you know, you've used the word collective to describe ICE, and I think it's a beautiful word. And when you were first putting the group together, you've told the story that you were very strongly counseled to separate out the concepts of marketing and education and really focus that grant on just one thing. But you could not do it. You really saw it even back then when you were still, I guess, a student or having recently finished it at Oberlin. You saw this as kind of a gestalt in the way that you approached the reshaping of concert life. Talk about that.
Yeah, I mean, for ICE, for me, and I think I can speak for the group in saying this, then and now, you know, these things are not separate. We think about separation as this thing that helps us control life and helps us give focus and definition to things. And really, it the idea of separation causes us a lot of suffering as human beings and as artists and as collaborators.
Well, the idea of compartmentalizing
is
almost a negative word, isn't it?
And so for ICE, I mean, we look at all of these things as part of the same gesture and part of the same responsibility. And that was a springboard for the group from the very beginning, and it continues to be now. And in that way, you know, we're just beginning. We're beginning our work. Every day, every time we sit down, you know, this morning we sat down on this stage with Steve at 9:30 and played Ravel, and it was a beginning. Yeah. And it'll be a beginning in just a few moments when he gets out there and plays music that he's played, I mean, how many times? I think he's done Safa maybe 700, 800 times in his life. Mm-hmm. And I hear him do it, and it's a first experience for me every time. And that, I think, is, you know, the definition of aliveness.
Well, the idea of recreation in performance, you know, creating something new every time.
Yeah.
That's where the excitement lies, absolutely. And tell us a little bit about the listening room, how you're bringing kids into this process.
Yeah, well, the listening room is it's an educational program for K through 12. And the listening room is basically a room in which we listen, which is precisely the thing we often don't do. Adults don't do a great job of listening. And kids do a fantastic job of listening. Mm-hmm. And what we decided is that if we just gave kids a room, a proverbial room, but also a blank sheet of paper and a space where they could listen to themselves, the sounds of their desks, the sounds of pencils, the sounds of their bodies, if we have fixed contact microphones to them, the sounds of anything, any found or created instruments. And they're given time to write down whatever thoughts, whatever stories, whatever images come to their mind on a blank piece of paper. We then enact these as pieces of music, and the kids are immediately creating really, really astounding works of art. And we do ICE, that is, we do 60-second to 2-minute versions of these pieces, of these phenomenal graphic scores that come from kids who have absolutely no musical experience. They're not told how to notate something. They use their intuition, they use their phenomenal imaginations, and they walk away understanding that they are composers. Wow. And that they're listeners.
And these are in schools where there aren't necessarily arts programs. And
where
they
there
don't
are no music,
music
programs
lessons,
whatsoever. Yeah.
Where they, wow, that's great. Well, Claire Chase, what a privilege and pleasure to talk to you. Congratulations on what you've already accomplished at this festival. You have a lot more to do and a lot more to play, and it's really a joy to talk to you and meet you.
Thank you so much. Pleasure.